Buenas tardes a todos y gracias por permitirnos estar con ustedes una vez más. Mi nombre es Yolanda Velázquez, soy miembro de la Junta Directiva del Instituto de Cultura Hispana de Houston y en esta oportunidad realmente quiero agradecer primero que todo al Consulado General de Houston, al ministro Gabriel Volpi y a la Casa Argentina por su apoyo con esta iniciativa Spotlight Argentina. Igualmente agradezco a todos los que nos han seguido y aprovecho para invitarlos a los eventos que tenemos pendientes. El próximo jueves estaremos con la artista Marina Fernández. El próximo martes tendremos tango y para concluir nuestro programa estaremos presentando vinos cerca desde Argentina. Ellos pueden adquirir sus vinos para degustar con nosotros y de alguna manera vivir esta experiencia. Welcome everybody. It's a pleasure to have all of you here with us this afternoon. My name is Yolanda Velázquez, and I'm talking in the name of the Institute of Hispanic Culture of Houston. You can see in our presentation, we have our mission, and we invite you to check our website for future events and ways to support us, either as a member through our donations or just to follow up in the events and the programs. Here you can see what we are doing and then you can know about us a little bit more. So para quienes lo tienen aquí en la pantalla con nuestra misión, los invitamos a seguirnos en nuestro website. Okay, among our guests today in our panel, we have Dr. Jorge Iglesias. He is native in Buenos Aires. He's from Buenos Aires. He is Estonian, and he has been reading about the movements, the postmodernism and the vanguard movement, and he will be supporting us during this interview. Dr. Jorge Iglesias estará con nosotros, experto en los movimientos de vanguardia, nos apoyará en esta entrevista. So this afternoon, we have our special guest, Mrs. Marene Sicardi. She is the founder of the gallery Sicardi Ayers Barcino. With her, we have Mr. William Isbell, Senior Sales Associate, who can respond some of the questions in English. So we'll be back and forth as this is a bilingual presentation. So una vez más, bienvenida la señora Marene Sicardi. Un honor tenerla con nosotros, fundadora y directora de la galería Sicardi Ayers Barcino. La señora María Inés viene desde Buenos Aires. Ella ha llegado a Houston en 1989. En ese momento fundó la galería Sicardi Sanders en 1994 y su propósito era introducir los artistas de vanguardia latinoamericanos. En ese momento casi totalmente desconocidos en Houston. Su labor pionera y la galería están reconocidas globalmente como promotores de la innovación y de estos movimientos artísticos. La Galería Sicardi Ayers Barcino en este momento es un diseño arquitectónico del reconocido arquitecto argentino Fernando Brave y se encuentra en el Distrito de Museos de Houston. Para presentarla, hablará el doctor Iglesias, les presentará un poco acerca de la galería más tarde en inglés, así que no quiero entrar a repetir lo que volvamos a repetir. So, sin más preámbulos, le doy la bienvenida a la señora Marene Sicardi. Es un placer, es un honor tenerla con nosotros. Y me gustaría, pues, ya dejarle el micrófono y que nos contara un poco acerca de cómo fue esa experiencia de fundar la galería, qué artistas, cómo empezó esta historia de la galería Sicardi Ayers Barcino. Por favor, señora Marene.
Bueno, muchísimas gracias. Antes que nada por invitarme. Es un placer estar con miembros del instituto y acercarme a la comunidad latinoamericana, a quienes conocí apenas llegué y quienes me apoyaron realmente desde el principio. Yo llegué a Houston en el 89, pero bueno, lo primero que hice fue recorrer las galerías de arte en ese momento, espacios culturales, y realmente noté una falta de obra de Sudamérica. Casi todo lo que se veía era de México. Estuve con uno de mis primeros viajes, viajé a Buenos Aires, traje obra de algunos artistas y realmente empecé a promoverlos acá en Houston. es interesante porque las cosas se dieron de una forma súper natural y orgánica, no fueron desarrollándose de a poco. Pero bueno, vendí dos obras, me dio tanto entusiasmo que pensé que algún día iba a tener una galería. Eso fue en el año 90, creo. Bueno, en el 94, en diciembre, encontré un espacio, me encantó, muy chiquito, pero bien ubicado en la calle Kipling, atrás de Rex Prime, que todavía está allí, es muy gracioso. Era un local pequeño. Bueno, lo alquilé y ahí tuve exhibiciones y ahí empecé la galería hasta el año 2001, en donde ya nos mudamos a otro espacio. Lo que realmente me pareció que es importante en este caso fue que realmente sentí con cada evento que pasaba que realmente la comunidad estaba celebrando que hubiera un lugar dedicado al arte en Latinoamérica. Al poco tiempo de abrir la galería, conocí a Zúbica Angelini de Venezuela, una persona que hoy en día tiene Transart Foundation, con un edificio acá, una cuadra de nuestro, que realmente ella se acercó a la galería, organizó exhibiciones de artistas cubanos, que fueron un éxito en su momento. Después conocí anteriormente, en realidad, a Wendy Watley, directora de PhotoFest. Ella tenía un gran interés en la fotografía latinoamericana, había viajado muchísimo a Latinoamérica. Yo tuve la posibilidad de ver una gran exhibición, fue en el año 91-92, y bueno, y de ver allí a los fotógrafos más importantes de Latinoamérica, Mario Pravoneto, brasilero, Abelardo Morelli, Luis Mayo, cubano, Luis González Palma de Guatemala, un grupo de artistas de México. O sea, de a poco fui conociendo y conectándome con muchos artistas y eligiendo lo que me parecía que era más importante o que podía tener una mejor recepción en Houston. Y realmente pensando en que estos artistas que eran tan conocidos en Latinoamérica, a lo mejor teniendo una galería en Houston, íbamos a poder promocionarlos, ubicar sus obras en museos, etc. Fue interesante porque me acuerdo ahora, no sé, fueron varias, pero una de las obras que el Museo de Houston, que a través de Ann Tucker, la curadora de fotografía, compró, fue de Luis Mayo, un artista cubano, vivía en Nueva York. O sea, hay, bueno, tengo tantas historias de esas. Conocí a Fernando La Rosa, estaba teniendo una exhibición en el Houston Center for Photography, me invité a exhibir en la galería y lo representé por muchos años. Luego, entre todo eso, conocí a Fernando Castro, crítico, fotógrafo, filósofo, fue después el curador de fotografía de la galería, escribió textos para muchos de nuestros catálogos o brochures. En ese momento no eran catálogos, pero eran textos para cada exhibición o para muchas de ellas. Y entre todo esto, bueno, también se acercaron a la galería coleccionistas, entre ellos Alison y David Ayers, y luego Carlos Bacino. Les encantó el arte, les gustó el proyecto de la galería. Bueno, ellos terminaron siendo socios en el año 99 o 2000. Parte de las cosas también así interesantes es que en el año, creo que fue 96, bueno, antes en realidad, yo en uno de mis viajes a Buenos Aires, uno de los artistas me había comentado de una curadora de Texas que era muy importante, Mari Carmen Ramírez. Yo no sabía todavía en ese momento quién era, debo confesar. Pero bueno, después de un par de años de tener la galería, llamé a Austin, al Huntington, hablé con Mari Carmen Ramírez, armamos un grupo para visitarla y fuimos de visita, nos mostró la colección del museo. Claro, Austin era, o Mari Carmen en ese momento, era uno de los pocos espacios en donde había realmente, se estaba coleccionando arte latinoamericano en profundidad, se estaban haciendo exhibiciones realmente importantes. Y bueno, así empezó la relación con la curadora de Huntington en ese momento y realmente nos ayudó a aprender. Vimos muchísimas exhibiciones excelentes en ese lugar. Me acuerdo una de ellas, el Real Lightning Vision, que era una exhibición de dibujo. Allí, por ejemplo, conocí y vi la obra por primera vez de Oscar Muñoz, Miguel Ángel Rojas, León Ferrari, con los cuales estamos trabajando ya hace más de 10 años. O sea, todas esas exhibiciones sirvieron para aprender, para conocer el trabajo en profundidad, seguir el trabajo de esos artistas que vi por primera vez por varios años, porque no los invitábamos directamente, inmediatamente, sino que realmente se hacía un seguimiento de la obra, ¿no es cierto? Bueno, fui a España, a la Reina Sofía, vi la exhibición de Heterotopía, que fue otra exhibición así sumamente importante en mi carrera, digamos, porque allí descubrí a Diego por primera vez, con una obra fantástica, importante, impresionante, grande. Vi la obra de Soto, de los 10 artistas que luego, maestros del movimiento cinético, en ese momento viviendo ambos en París. Pero bueno, después de varios años, los fui a visitar a Venezuela, los conocí y empezaron a trabajar con nosotros. Así que ha sido realmente un proceso de mucho conocimiento, de relación sobre todo. Para mí siempre fue sumamente importante la relación con el otro y cultivar esa relación con los seres queridos, con los familiares, con los galeristas, con los artistas, con la gente que uno tiene alrededor, con los coleccionistas. En el año 2001, bueno, el año 99, fines del 99, principios del 2000, invité a Alison y David y a Carlos a hacerse socios de la galería, y ya de allí planeamos tener un espacio más grande para poder realmente mostrar de la mejor manera posible a los artistas que queríamos representar. Realmente en ese momento ya teníamos la decisión de crecer, de tener una galería importante, de seguir viajando, de realmente ubicar la obra de estos artistas en colecciones importantes, en museos, y realmente ayudarles a afianzar su carrera en los Estados Unidos. Claro, con los años la galería se fue definiendo también, porque al principio, bueno, no sabíamos muy bien, no lo sabía que realmente fui aprendiendo y bueno, fuimos decidiendo y viendo que era importante tener un grupo de artistas con un establo fijo, más bien fijo, y realmente hacer algo importante por cada uno de ellos. Y así hemos estado trabajando realmente hasta ahora. Este año estamos celebrando los 25 años de la galería y realmente estamos bueno, contentos, a pesar de la pandemia.
Bueno, felicitaciones por esos 25 años de trabajo y la verdad, un nombre reconocido en Houston y no solo en Houston, globalmente. Hemos tocado un poco el tema de los artistas, de cómo fueron estos primeros contactos. Quisiera un poquitico acerca de cómo fue la visión del público, cómo fue la reacción y cómo ha sido la relación, por ejemplo, porque sé que Mari Carmen está con el Museo de Artes. ¿Cómo es la relación ahora con el Museo de Artes, de Finas Artes de Houston? Si nos puedes hablar un momentico de esto.
Bueno, o sea, con el Museo de Houston nosotros tenemos una relación, obviamente, porque, o sea, nosotros, el museo abrió el Departamento de Arte Latinoamericano en el año 2001. Yo hacía ya años que estaba trabajando. Yo empecé a vender arte en el año 90 y abrí la galería en el 94. O sea que ya en ese entonces, cuando el museo abrió, la galería tenía una base de coleccionistas y de gente interesada en el arte latinoamericano. Algunos latinos y otros americanos realmente que venían a las exhibiciones, compraban arte, apoyaban el proyecto y asimismo, de a poco, las instituciones y otros coleccionistas de otros lugares de Estados Unidos nos habían contactado, estaban interesados en apoyar el proyecto, o sea, se fue dando, o sea, todo como muy orgánicamente. Y así, en la misma manera que conocí a Mari Carmen en Austin, a que la conocimos y seguimos su trabajo, viajamos a muchas otras ciudades a ver exhibiciones, a México, a Brasil, hemos ido a bienales, hemos ido a muchos países y lugares del mundo para ver qué era lo que estaba pasando y para apoyar a nuestros artistas cuando eran invitados en esos, a esos eventos. Cada vez que los artistas tenían exhibiciones en otros países, nosotros íbamos para acompañarlos, etc. Entonces, desde el principio hubo una relación importante con el Museo de Houston, porque nosotros estábamos obviamente interesados en que el museo tuviera un curador de arte latinoamericano. Inclusive habíamos tenido en un momento una reunión con 30 personas importantes de la comunidad latinoamericana, con Peter Marzio, pidiéndole que abrieran un departamento de arte latinoamericano, que hicieran un grupo de apoyo al museo. En ese momento no funcionó, pero es interesante, años más tarde, Mari Carmen es llamada por Peter Marzio, abre el departamento de arte latinoamericano con un proyecto a largo plazo, y realmente, bueno, nosotros ya teníamos una base de coleccionistas que forman a partir de ese momento el grupo de apoyo al proyecto del museo. Entonces, claro, era gente que ya conocía y conoció a Mari Carmen, se interesó en ese proyecto, y obviamente el proyecto del Museo de Houston es el más importante que hay, yo creo que en el mundo en este momento, o sea, la colección, la calidad de las obras que tienen, la embargadura, el Instituto el Centro de Investigación, el ICA, es también importantísimo, o sea, también vale decir que además de apoyar museos como Houston, nosotros estamos en contacto y hemos conocido durante todos estos años curadores de muchísimos museos. O sea, acabamos de vender obras al LACMA, el Museo de Los Ángeles, County Museum of Art. Hemos vendido obras al MoMA, al Tate Modern, al Museo de Art, o sea, a muchísimas instituciones de Estados Unidos y de Europa. Así que, bueno, es parte de nuestra misión y de nuestro trabajo a largo plazo.
And one of the major goals of the gallery has always been not to just place our artists in private collections, but to work with institutions and major museums and have their work available in those institutions. That's always been at the foremost of what the gallery has tried to accomplish for all of our artists.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Ok, como decía nuestro título, abriendo puertas, Mari Carmen, es realmente una labor pionera y no solo para el arte latinoamericano, como lo dices, ya estabas aquí cuando el museo abrió. Bueno, ahora tengo el placer de dejarlos con nuestro invitado, el doctor Iglesias, quien continuará con nuestra entrevista y hablaremos un poco de la galería. Now, Dr. Iglesias is going to talk to you about the space, the gallery itself. William, you will be in charge of some of these questions. So, Dr. Iglesias, are you there?
Sí, aquí estoy.
Gracias.
Bueno, ante todo, María Inés y William, es un honor tenerlos aquí con nosotros. Quiero dar una breve reseña para nuestro público acerca de la galería y luego pasamos a las preguntas en inglés. Bueno, para los que no conocen la galería, les contamos que se encuentra en el centro del Distrito de Museos de Houston, justo frente a la famosa colección Menil. Es un espacio diseñado por el arquitecto argentino Fernando Brave y su compañía Brave Architecture, y cuenta con un diseño modernista en sus dos niveles y amplias salas de exhibición que están excepcionalmente adecuadas para la apreciación y el disfrute del arte. Después vamos a ver un poquito más acerca de la galería en unos segundos. So moving on to some other questions that we had in English. I was wondering if you could tell us about your headquarters a little bit in the present. For those
of you who are,
this is a beautiful space. Maybe tell us a little bit about the recent exhibits that you have had.
Sure, so the space was designed 8 years ago as kind of a continuation of bringing the Latin American artistic endeavor to Houston. A really great choice was made to select an Argentinian architect, Fernando Grave, who is based here at headquartered here in Houston, and is a fantastic architect in the city. And it was great because, you know, not only the goal of the gallery was always to showcase Latin American art, that was always going to be the focus. And so to bring a Latin American architect in, you know, the space that one sees artwork in so integral to your experience of viewing the work and your relationship to the work. And, you know, I think everybody agrees, we always get comments on how beautiful a space it is. And he came in and we have two galleries. We have the large gallery downstairs. Upstairs we have a smaller gallery. And then we have a viewing room, which you'll see later in the interview. And he did a remarkable job thinking about how the spaces work, how they flow into each other. It really is a beautiful, beautiful building.
Yes, he understood very well what we needed, because that was a long conversation, no? With the experience that we had and what we needed for the sure. exhibitions that we were planning.
And the space works so well, you know. It's very difficult sometimes to curate shows and paint shows in a difficult space. And this space makes it very easy to do those things, which is really what our job is, to showcase the art at its best. And having this amazing environment, architecturally speaking, in which to do that, just it helps us do our job innately.
And our viewers can see some of the images here from outside and inside. As you can see, it's just a beautiful space. It just draws you in, right? I wanted also to ask you about the international projection of the gallery. Yours is a gallery that has participated in art fairs worldwide. So could you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure. You know, I think we have participated in art fairs throughout the world, but I think all of that, you know, kind of everything in the gallery really starts with our artists, right? I mean, when you look at our masters, the roster of the gallery is really split into two groups. We have our modern masters of the 20th century and our contemporary artists that are alive and working still. And when you look at our masters, they were, many of them, as was the tradition here in the US, many of them in Latin America, went to Europe, particularly France and
yes.
Paris.
They were living in Paris.
That's right. So the kinetic movement, Cruz Diaz, Soto, Otero spent quite a bit of time there, Antonio Assis, Julio Laparque. So they're all there. So we have this natural connection to Europe and an international connection just via our artists. And then when you look at our more contemporary roster, we have artists like Maria Sanz, who left Argentina to go study in Italy, and that's really where she kind of honed her craft, and she fell in love with the material, one of the materials that she's well known for now, which is Italian marble, and then moved to Paris and lives and works in Paris now. So by the very essence of our artists, which is, and it's important to note that the artists are always the kind of the heartbeat of the gallery, right? We wouldn't be here if it weren't. And so because they have an international connection, it's that just by necessity, we have that same connection. And
sometimes they are exhibiting in Paris and the Jeux de Pomme or in the Reina Sofía in Madrid, and we always go and participate and help them.
That's right. Our artists are in collections all over the world, from, you know, Australia to Barcelona. It's just a fantastic roster of people that we get to work with. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. Now, we were hoping that you'd give us a tour of the gallery. So maybe while you set up, our viewers can look at some images of the art that you can see there. And we'll come back to you once you're ready to talk to us again.
Sure.
Okay, so you can see some images here from the gallery, and while we wait for Maria Ines and William, as they're ready to keep talking to us, I just wanted to give you a few details about what you're seeing here. For instance, this piece that you're looking at right now is by Magdalena Fernandez, who is a Venezuelan artist, and it's made with iron spheres and a kind of a flexible cord. One thing to keep in mind about much, if not most of the work that you can see at the gallery is that this is kinetic art, as Maria Ines was saying. It's art that involves the viewer directly. It's something that has to be appreciated in person because you are a part of the appreciation of these works of art. We are going
to- All right, we're ready whenever you are.
Okay, so something that I wanted to ask you about this part of the gallery that is directed directly related to it is what is in your exhibition right now? What is on display?
So we have two exhibitions currently. We have our Dialogues exhibition, which is really looking at the conversations and connections between our masters and our contemporary artists. And then upstairs, we have the first solo exhibition of a young Guatemalan artist, Sandra Mafaroso. And so we'll kind of walk you through downstairs, and then I think you have a couple more images to show while we go upstairs, and then we'll walk through the gallery there as well. So the Dialogues really starts, since the focus of this talk is really Argentina, it's great to start with Leo Ferrari. You know, definitely one of the most important artists to come out of Argentina, certainly in the 20th century. And his work was really split between abstraction and linear form, and also being very involved with his art as a political statement, given the dictatorship in Argentina at the time. But this is a beautiful sculpture of his done from stainless steel and silver solder. And when you look at his drawings, there's this incredible fluidity to how he is abstracting. Often his inspiration is written form and toying with the notion of making drawings and sculptures out of writing and writing out of drawing and sculpture. With the essence of that body of his work, if you think about it, you know, writing is simply linear form to communicate. Drawing is simply linear form to communicate. There really is no philosophical difference between those two. And Ferrari was a master at playing with the threshold of where one of those fell off and the other began. And then in the background, of course, when we were seated, you saw a work by Jesus Soto. It's a contemporary of Carlos Ruiz Diaz, both very active and probably two of the most well-known members of the Kinetic Movement, both very active in Paris. And so as we move into the open space, you can see when we were talking about Fernando and his work in the gallery, the nice tall ceilings really helps frame the work and keeps the lights and everything out of it, so that what you experience is really just the crux of the visual. So you can see here we have a fantastic example of one of the Physicromies by Carlos Ruiz Diaz. And Ruiz Diaz was just a master of manipulating space and movement through color. Where Soto relied more heavily on manipulation of movement through line and linear form, and color was really secondary. Ruiz Diaz was really a fantastic colorist and color theorist, and pushed that form really to its bounds. And one of the most impressive things about Ruiz Diaz was he passed away this past year, months shy of 96. But up until the last years of his life, he was always looking for new technology, how he can incorporate it in his work. So many artists, when they get older, kind of plunk down and really just focus on what they want. And Ruiz Diaz was never satisfied. He was always looking, what's the next thing I can do? Where can I take it? And embracing technology as a means of getting there instead of finding it. We can look here at, this is an artist, Gabriel de la Mora, out of Mexico City. And Gabriel's work is often based on reference materials that have been discarded. And in this case, it's not just hard art materials, but he was inspired by finding some of these. He ended up having to purchase them because he was able to find them in the quantities that he needed. And when he does that, he uses it in a way that negates its original intent. He is a meticulous artist, which is kind of a trait that many of our artists share here at the gallery. But the whole point of a cover slip in microscopy is it's a small piece of glass and it's designed to become, to disappear when light hits it, because you want to be able to see your specimen. So Gabrielle has positioned it in a way that when light hits them, that is when they become most visible. And as the lights shift, the patterning changes on the background of the artwork. Another interesting trait of many of Gabrielle's works are that they can be hung over the portrait orientation, as you see here. They can also be hung sideways in the landscape. And when you do that, you manipulate how it's hung. It changes all the patterning of the work, reads very differently to the work. We have a fantastic sculpture here in our gallery. It is rated for outdoor sales. It can definitely be out in the park. And this is a reader. And this is New York College stainless steel sculpture. It is very heavily playing with lines and planes, and almost in this augmented reality, this virtual reality, shifting your orientation, you know, finding where you are, if it's a little bit screening, you get up next to it. So Rebecca can pass out that on her way, and then we'll also talk about Mercedes Park. So Mercedes Pardo was an artist out of Venezuela. She passed away about 2005, and she was a phenomenal colorist, but also the way she developed her compositions as an abstract painter is just impeccable. She's really not as well known in the U.S., and that's largely for two reasons. One is she happened to be married to one of the most famous artists in Venezuela, Alejandro Otero, but also because she was a female artist in the 80s and 70s. There are a number of amazing female artists that were simply overlooked. So the gallery was thrilled to somewhat recently have a solo exhibition of her work and really showcase her contribution to the Latin American art world. You know, when you come in and you look at how she manipulates form, the planes that you think are parallel are just a few millimeters off. And that subtle shift just totally changes how you relate to the work and associate with the work. And I think another artist of ours that is definitely worth mentioning is Marco Lacci. Marco's work is all about, in a world where everything is at a fast pace, everything is just happening 90 miles a minute, Marco's world is about slowing everybody down. And if you speed through his work, you simply won't get it. In fact, he represented Uruguay, and there's been out of years ago. When you walked into the room, it was all white on white. So there was this white paper cuts on the walls, on a white wall. And I know one of our clients from Miami was telling me the story that they went all the way, they were excited to see this work, and they were in such a hurry, they just poked their head in and then left because they thought they had time to install. And so they missed his whole exhibition because they just couldn't slow down. And that's really the point of Marco's work. When you get up to it, he's developed his own little language of form out of these minute paper cuts. In this case, they're framed in a 35 millimeter slide frame. But it's just marvelous work. And then I think we'll look at Thomas Glassford's work. Mm-hmm. And then I think you have a couple images that you can show while we upstairs. This is Ana, as we go there, this is Ana Maria Tavares out of Brazil. This is one of her contamination series that's really looking at modern architecture in Brazil, and in particular the Oscar Niemeyer building, and the contamination of form. And trying to control nature with some of those modernist architects, and trying to control nature, how it picks up and is contaminated by outdoor nature, and it's reflecting forms around So it's a really beautiful work, both physically and conceptually. And then Tommy Glassford. Thomas Glassford is an artist out of Mexico City. He was actually born in Texas. He's from Laredo, but works and lives in Mexico City. And this is one of his Stella series pieces. And this has long been a favorite of mine at the gallery. I know we're not supposed to have favorites, but we all do. And it's made from broom handles, and it's really looking at the amounts, the immense array of materials. And when you think about broom handle manufacturing, you think that's such a niche market, right? But there really is this wide array of colors and shapes and forms that, you know, some are textured, some aren't. And so these are all broom handles that he collected and bartered and traded for in Mexico. Many of them have, you know, kind of are imprinted with the names of the people that were using them. And also creating, Tommy loves to toy with this notion of creating, taking very mundane objects, very commonplace everyday objects, sometimes not thought of as being very lofty objects, and creating this kind of high art out of that. And so I think if you want to show the other couple of images that you have, we'll head upstairs and then we'll rejoin you there.
So just to give you a quick preview, just very brief information here. What you're about to see is an exhibit by Sandra Monterroso called Threads of Memory. Monterroso is a Guatemalan artist. And while we wait for Maria Ines and William to set up, you can also appreciate some of the other art that you can see at Sicardi Gallery. As you could see, and as William told us, this is art that invites multiple perspectives, right? And you're going to see a little bit more of that in the Monterroso exhibit that William is going to tell us about right now.
Sephora, just let me know when you're ready and we can start.
We're ready.
William, excuse me. William, yes. Could you change your microphone, please? Sometimes when you move, it is it's a little bit lost. I don't know if it's, I know the space is big and.
Is that better? Know,
yes, a lot better. Thank you so much.
Normally people tell me to talk more quietly.
So and it's a beautiful, big space. So now.
This is the work of Sandra Monterroso. She's a Guatemalan artist, fairly young. She's about my age, so let's just say she's really young. And she's really working with, in this body of work, with the culture of the indigenous Maya culture in Guatemala and looking at and exploring pre-colonialism and post-colonialism, how everything changed. And so she's using, you'll notice all the blues in this, and that's because in this she is kind of reclaiming an ancient tradition of working with indigo dye. And this is specifically a species of indigo that is native to Guatemala. And it's a very in-depth process. The pH matters, the temperature of the water matters. And she had to work with some anthropologists who have studied this to really, like I said, reclaim this process that's been lost. In Guatemala, originally there were kind of co-op groups that would work the land together. And when the colonizers came in, they made that illegal. Essentially, the indigenous population was forced into what is ultimately slave labor. In the US, we could equate it more like a sharecropping thing, but it was a kind of forced labor. And she's using a lot of the items that were important, not only the dye, but also each of these hanging pieces, each is an individual piece. You can see the hanging installation here. It's all done with yarn. Each piece contains 13 knots, which of course is a significant number in the Maya culture. And she's working to control the different blues with the amount of dye. You can see her paddles. The paddles are integral in the dyeing process and are used in that. And when she and I were talking, it was also very interesting because we both remarked that in a country that is so well known for textile, None of this, all of this yarn is produced in Germany. They don't have it anymore. They don't have it available in Guatemala. And so, you know, something that the country is known for, the raw materials for, they're going to have to import now. And all of that ties back to kind of the history, agricultural history of the indigenous culture and then the population that came in and reordered everything. We can also go look next door into our viewing room. So our viewing room is essentially a small gallery upstairs, a small space that where we house multiple examples of all the different artists that we showcase here at the gallery. And this is kind of the, you know, how in your house, I always joke with clients, in your house you have two closets, one that company can see and one that company can't go into. Well, our company can go into closets downstairs, but up here, this is the one company you can see. This is a little back room. So you can see on the racks, we're able to pull out examples when clients come in and they want to look at particular artists. We also sometimes treat it as a small exhibition space. So we have a lot of clients that have a little bit more conservative taste of modernism. And so we put together a small gallery wall here that fits that. It's largely based in School of the South, which is an important art movement out of Uruguay. But that was the original intent, but it kind of expanded from there. There were just too many great choices to. We also have some fantastic Western works here by Melanie Smith. Melanie is an English artist, but she has lived and worked out of Mexico City for most of her career. Much of her art focuses on the Latin American experience. And this is actually, she took from UT's collection of early American artists like Remington. She took a look at that and was exploring that and kind of from that developed a system of new paintings, and they're really remarkable. When you start getting in here and you start seeing how painterly she is with the application of the acrylic, it's really wonderful, wonderful work. And we can definitely look at other pieces, but I know we wanted to check and see if anyone had any questions that they would like us to answer.
So before we move on to the questions, I wanted to ask you one important one.
Sure.
For those who are contemplating acquiring a work of art, those who are thinking of it maybe as an investment, who are the artists that are best quoted in the market? What kind of prices are we talking about?
You know, I think there are two ways of collecting. So the question that you're posing is more of an art as commodity question, right? And there is, in essence, two ways of collecting art, right? You can collect, you can build your collection on what you love, and you can build your collection based on market prices and commodity and really treat the art as a, like a stock, like you would treat a stock. While that is one way of collecting art, what we really advise, and certainly what I advise all of my clients here at the gallery, is collect what you love. I mean, you know, it's always so beautiful to go into a client's house and to see their collection. It's such this unique fingerprint of how they think about art, how they relate to it, how they relate to their space. And it's maybe even they have a spouse and they have disparate takes on art. So how you reconcile those within a single collection, it tells this beautiful story. And so I think, you know, the first thing I would say to a client is collect what you love. Find something that is just innate, visceral in you that elicits this visceral response, and then learn about that artist. Learn about the different bodies of work. We have an amazing library here, and we, you know, would certainly always be open to clients coming in and reading about artists that they like. We can also direct them to publications. We love educating our collectors and sending them catalogs and sending them articles so that they can learn more about the artist. And we can have this wonderful exchange and this dialogue about their work and the aesthetics of it and how it could fit into their collection. So I would say steering someone in that direction and to not be scared of collecting, right? And I think too, when you say the word, oh, I'm an art collector, so many people have this lofty notion of, that means you live in a mansion up on a hill and you have this, you know, you have Rembrandts in your bathroom and Picassos in the attic. And the reality is that if you have art on your wall, even if they're posters from college, you're an art collector, right? You have a collection. You may have a poster collection, you may have a specific collection. So I think get over the notion of what is a collector. A collector is anyone that has something hanging on the wall that is an artistic form. And so once you embrace the sense that you're a collector, start curating your collection like a collector. Build your eye, you know, develop your eye, and really embrace the fact that collecting isn't something that 5 years down the road, you're gonna be able to tick that box and say, okay, my collection's finally done. You know, it's a lifelong project. It's addictive, I'll warn you, it's addictive, but it's a lifelong endeavor. And as you change, as your life experiences change, your relationship to your art is going to change too. And it's beautiful to see that arc visually represented in someone's house. So, you know, that's the initial advice I would give to someone. And then, you know, we would certainly always encourage people to come in and talk to us about what their goals are. And, you know, you don't have to be, some people come to the gallery and they think, oh, no, don't, you know, you don't have to talk to me because I can't afford something. The reality is we have works here from $1,500 all the way to $1.25 million. I mean, everything in between. So everybody is able to collect, and we have something for everyone. And so come in and have a conversation with us about what your goals are. And we love that. We love relating to our clients on that level.
Great. That's a great definition. And one final question, very briefly. This is for both of you. Could you tell us what the future plans for the gallery are, el futuro de la galería?
Sure. So we have, obviously Houston is our heart, right? This is where we're located. We are always going to continue our programming here. We have, you know, on average about 10 exhibitions a year, sometimes a little less, sometimes a little more. So that is never going to change. And so one of the things we have had a long tradition of doing is representation on the East Coast, in Miami, at Basel, New York, and Freeze and Armory and the ADA show, also in Chicago. So we're going to maintain that East Coast presence, but we would really love to, we have a lot of collectors that are interested on the West Coast in the LA and Bay Area market, and so we really are looking to expand that direction and to showcase our artists there. We're also always looking for ways, and you know, if there has been any silver lining of COVID, it has been that we are constantly trying to develop new ways for our clients that maybe can't come into the gallery because they don't live here. Ways for them to experience the exhibitions that we put on in a way that upholds the integrity of the exhibition, of the visual experience of walking through an exhibition. So we're updating our online technology, and we're doing more videos now. We're doing a lot of interviews talking about, we hosted several artist talks and book signings for people that can that are recorded so they can come and see those and learn more about the artist firsthand. So that's really where our focus is, Marines.
Yes. I think that our focus was always first the United States. We are really focusing in Houston, Texas right now. And then we'll go to, you know, in the future, I think that is explore the east, the West Coast, you know, California, San Francisco. We have contacts there. We have been selling visits to some museums in that area, but we would like to participate in some art fairs probably in that kind of part of the country. And in the future, Europe.
Hong Kong, maybe.
Yes, of course.
Maria Ines, William, it has been an absolute honor for me to talk to you. And now we will go back to Ms. Velasquez. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Gracias, Dr. Iglesias. Thank you to William and Maria Ines. It has been really a privilege and such an honor to visit the gallery, to see such an amazing collection, and the fact that just the building is beautiful. So that's amazing. I have a couple of comments here. From the Casa Argentina, nos preguntan, ¿cuál es su opinión, Marenés, sobre la evolución del arte argentino?
la evolución del arte argentino. Bueno, creo que tenemos artistas extraordinarios. O sea, Latinoamérica es súper interesante porque hay, creo que son 23 países, y cada país tiene como una línea de arte, una gama de artistas. Argentina estuvo siempre al frente y tiene artistas de sumamente importantes. Creo que hay que seguir, hay que apoyar. Estamos en un momento difícil. Argentina es el último país del continente, entonces del continente americano. Entonces todo lo que uno pueda hacer desde acá, colaborar, tener proyectos en común, es fabuloso, realmente importante. Pero creo que realmente ha sido un país con mucha educación, gran cultura, grandes artistas, escritores, o sea, es un país que va a seguir adelante a pesar de todas las crisis.
De la situación. Bueno, y tengo un comentario más. Le quisiera pasar el micrófono a María Pérez. La doctora María Pérez es parte de nuestra junta directiva y quiere hacer un comentario en vivo. María, por favor.
No, agradecerles a todos por esta maravillosa presentación sobre esta galería, que de verdad es un privilegio y un honor contar con este espacio en Houston, que nos ha abierto los ojos a una manera diferente de ver el arte, de apreciarlo. Y como dijo María Inés, son artistas extraordinarios que sin la labor que ella ha hecho quizás no serían tan conocidos en nuestro país y en el mundo, pero que de verdad han trascendido todas las fronteras para llevar nuestro arte a todo el mundo y no llevarlo solamente al mundo, sino llevarlo a la cima. Así que mil gracias, María Inés, mil gracias a Will por esta presentación, y a Yolanda y a Jorge, que también han participado, el doctor Iglesias, con estas preguntas que nos han ayudado a entender mucho mejor todo este arte.
Bueno, muchísimas gracias a todos ustedes y al Instituto de Cultura Hispánica, por supuesto. Siento muy honrada en haber sido invitada a participar.
Oh, thank you, de verdad, William, thank you. Y a usted muchas gracias, María Inés, por aceptar nuestra invitación y por este maravilloso tour. Del consulado de Houston tengo al señor cónsul, que también les manda un saludo especial. Les da las gracias, María Inés, por todo lo que hace por el arte argentino y el arte latinoamericano. Son directamente desde el consulado. Está un comentario, y al señor cónsul, muchas gracias por estar pendiente de nuestros programas. Igualmente, tengo a Sonia Graz dándole las gracias. Realmente ha sido un honor, un placer tener esta oportunidad de ver el arte, disfrutar, escuchar todos estos, verlo desde adentro, lo que es la galería. William, muchísimas gracias. Thank you very much, William, for your participation, for your support to this rehearsal. Really, such an amazing experience to be able to see this in these difficult times. We had an announcement that you sent. The gallery is open from Tuesday to Saturday, but we encourage people to do it by appointment, and the numbers are on the presentation.
So we're open by appointment only, but there you have two numbers on the presentation. They're welcome to call those numbers, and we're happy to set up an appointment for them to come in. And, you know, I think one other thing that has been, it was something I think I didn't know before I came to the gallery, I didn't really appreciate. And it was pointed out to me this past year, actually, when we were in Miami, Basel, and we were focusing in Basel on Venezuelan artists. So we had Mercedes Pardo, we had Alejandro Otero, we had Carlos Luis Diaz, Soto, and on numerous occasions, people walked in and I was in dialogue with them, and they would just start, you know, when you think about how emotional art can be, we sometimes forget, but they would just start crying, and it's because, you know, they had left Venezuela under the worst circumstances. And many of them said to me, you know, I remember three in particular, we were talking, and one of the ladies was just kind of crying. She was older, and she just said, you know, I left with the assumption that I would never go back to my country. And I never thought I would see some of the, I'm like, my picture right now. I never thought I would see some of these artists again. And she said, you don't know what it means to me to be able to come here and see these and be at home. And it was just,
yes, it's
really a phenomenal experience to see clients relate to the work on all different levels, but particularly that level.
Sí, me ha pasado muchas veces de gente que me agradece haber abierto una galería en Houston y haberles dado la oportunidad de conectarse con el arte de Latinoamérica, de conocer los artistas, porque cada vez que hacemos una exhibición los artistas vienen. Y es una experiencia única realmente.
Y sí, realmente.
Y ayudar a que la gente no esté intimidada por una galería, que era lo que sentía cuando yo llegué acá, que mucha gente tiene miedo, temor a entrar a una galería. Nosotros somos amigables. Welcome.
Bueno, María Inés, muchas gracias. Tengo un par de comentarios. Alguien me pregunta de la Casa Argentina, Sonia Grass, te manda a saludar y pregunta si sabes o puedes decir el nombre del próximo artista argentino que tienes de pronto pendiente en la galería, si ya tienes a alguien o no.
Bueno, Liliana Porter es una de los artistas que yo conocí hace 20 años y acabamos de cerrar hace 2 meses la exhibición individual número 10 de ella, Liliana Porter, una artista extraordinaria.
Bueno, muchísimas gracias. También le doy las gracias a Casa Argentina, que nos ha estado colaborando y que estaba muy interesado en hacer esta presentación. Casa Argentina, María Fernanda Bruno, ha sido un gran sponsor de este programa, Spotlight Argentina. And really, thank you so much for this time. I'm very glad we had the opportunity to sit together, to visit the gallery with you, and really, from the bottom of my heart, one of the places that I love in Houston that I feel so proud of having and being Latin American. I really know what you're talking about with you. Said, this is part of us in Houston. Okay? So, many thanks and see you soon. Marines, okay, thank William, you. Gracias, adiós.
Bye.